So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that it is not sufficient that you move around and not understand what you're doing. It is not sufficient that you utter some words and not understand what you're saying. It is not sufficient that you do a few rituals but not understand the underlying significance and meaning of those rituals. And when it comes to the slaughtering, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned the same thing. He said, لَنْ يَنَالُ اللَّهَ لُحُومُهَا وَلَا دِمَاؤُهَا وَلَكِنْ يَنَالُهُ التَّقْوَى مِنْكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, when you sacrifice the animal, it is not the meat or the blood of the animal that's going to reach Allah. It's not the blood is not going to Allah. The meat is not going to Allah. There are some people who worship idols. They put food in front of their idols, thinking that the idol will spiritually eat the food. And then they go and throw it away, and then the next day they'll bring more food and put it in front of the idols. Islam came to remove that superstitious nonsense. So how can we fall into the exact same trap that we've been actually liberated from? So we must understand that these things came in order to dedicate them, to dedicate these actions for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We perform all of these rites directly for the sake of Allah, not simply to make certain actions. We remember the sacrifice that Ibrahim alayhi salam made so that we can learn and we can make our own sacrifices. We do all of these things to become true Muslims. The same way Ibrahim said, I submit myself to the Lord of the worlds, we make sacrifices. We sacrifice our own desires, our own inclinations, and we put that aside and we submit ourselves to Allah. And that's how we gain this correct balance. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. You do the same. الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد الله أكبر 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 All praise belongs to Allah and Allah is the greatest. Continuing, we talked about these rituals and how we require the balance. We must have the understanding in the actions that we are doing. And if we do not have the balance and we do not have the understanding, what will happen? What will happen if we fail in acquiring the correct balance? The Prophet of Allah, peace be upon him, made a prophetic statement. A statement narrated by Abu Dawood and which has been authenticated by the scholars. He said that the different communities amongst the people, different teams, different groups, will team up against you, meaning the Muslims. There will come a time where different communities will team up against you the same way that people come together to attack the food at a party. You know exactly what I'm talking about. You put some nice nihari, you put some falafel on the middle of the table, and you see how people, you invite them, you see how they'll come and attack the food. What he's saying is that there will come a time when the Muslims will be like the food, and they will get attacked from every angle and from every group, and they will all cooperate with one another to come and attack you. From every angle. How? Military attack, political attack, smear campaigns, intellectual warfare, each and every single way they can muster up their forces, they will come and attack you. Now somebody, while hearing this statement from the Prophet, peace be upon him, he thought about it and he said, there's a question we must ask. He asked the question for us. He said, are we going to be few at that time? And it makes sense. It's a legitimate question. He said, how can somebody attack you? A bully picks on people who are smaller than him in number, people who are weaker than him. Bullies don't pick on people who are their own size or people who are bigger than them. So how could it be that the Muslims are getting attacked and picked on by people? We must be few at that time. It cannot apply to our age. The Pew Institute just did a research study that there are 1.57 billion Muslims in the world. That's 23% of the world's population. almost 1 in 4 people in the world are Muslim. So it can't possibly apply to our time. Legitimate question. And what did the Prophet, peace be upon him, answer? He said, no, you will be many. You will be great in number. But what's the issue? He said, you will be great in number, but you will be scum. This is what he said. He said, you will be scum like the trash that flows down the sewer with the sewer water. What is this? What is he referring to? He's referring to what some people can call the process of fermentation. The Muslim Ummah is going through one of those processes of fermentation. One of the characteristics of fermentation is that the scum begins to rise to the top. That means the people who are not fit to rule, the people who are not fit to lead, the people who are not fit to be in charge of the affairs of people, rise to the top. And this is what, unfortunately, he had predicted. He had predicted and told us that this is something that would happen. And he continued, and he explained, he said, when that time comes, Allah will remove the fear of you from the hearts of your enemies. They will not be scared of you. They will not be scared of you, and he will instill in your hearts weakness, al-wahn. He will remove from your enemies, from the hearts of your enemies, the fear of you. So what will take place? In the United States Congressional Auditorium, there will be groups of Islamophobes who meet up and talk about outlawing Islam in America. They will come and gather in a US Congressional Auditorium, and they will talk about taking how we can curtail the rights of the Muslims in America. There will be women, sisters, who are stabbed in Germany in a public courtroom at almost 20 times in front of everyone, and no one will do a single thing about it. Not a single president or politician will make even a statement of apology about it. There will be vandalizing of mosques. There will even be some that are shut down or confiscated. Sisters will have their hijabs ripped off. There will be hate crimes. All of these things will happen because there will be no awe, no respect, no dignity for the Muslims at that time. And what will happen to the Muslims themselves? He will instill in your hearts weakness, al-wahn. Now the word weakness, the word al-wahn, is understood by anyone who understands the Arabic language. It is a clear word, it's not a vague word. People understand what it is. But this same person who was asking those questions, he continued asking the questions. And he said, what is al-wahn? He asked the Prophet, peace be upon him, what is al-wahn? What is this weakness? He wanted to know, what is the root cause of this problem? How would the Muslims get into this situation in the first place? Because you need to know how we got into it. You need to know the root cause of the problem if you want to get out. It's not sufficient to simply put a band-aid on it and put a cast on it and say, okay, everything's going to be fine. So this man, alhamdulillah, he asked for us, what is the root cause of this problem? How can we get out of this? He said, the wahn, the root cause of this problem, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, حُبُّ الدُّنْيَا وَكَرَاهِيَةُ الْمَوْتِ. He said, the love of this life and the hatred of death.